Despite this setback, the Confederate government had an ingenious trick up their sleeves. The trick, like the sleeves themselves, was made of cotton. The South's idea was to use cotton as collateral to back its bonds. Investors would be comforted to know that even if the interest payments dried up, they could still demand their cotton instead. The South's agents went to work selling the bonds in the financial centers of Europe. When the Confederacy tried to market conventional bonds in European financial centers like Amsterdam's, investors wouldn't touch them with a barge pole. But when an obscure French firm named Emile Erlanger and Company offered cotton-backed bonds, it was a completely different story. The key to the success of the Erlanger bonds was that they could be converted into cotton at the pre-war price of 6 pence a pound. These cotton bonds formed the basis of the South's new financial strategy. If they could restrict the supply of cotton, its value and the value of the bonds would increase. At the same time, the Confederates set out to use cotton to blackmail the most powerful country in the world, Britain. In 1860, the Port of Liverpool was the principal gateway for imports of cotton to the British textile industry, then the mainstay of the Victorian industrial economy. More than 80% of the cotton came from the southern United States. Now that gave the Confederate leadership hope that they had the leverage to bring in Britain on their side in the Civil War. To ratchet up the pressure, they decided to impose an embargo on all shipments of cotton to Liverpool. For a while, the South's strategy worked brilliantly. Cotton prices soared. So did the value of the Confederates' cotton-backed bonds. And the cotton embargo devastated the British economy. Mills were forced to lay off workers. Eventually, in late 1862, production all but ceased. This cotton mill in Stile, south of Manchester, employed around 400 workers, but that was just a fraction of the 500,000 people employed by King Cotton across Lancashire. Obviously, with no cotton, there was nothing for people to do. By the end of 1862, half the entire workforce of Lancashire had been laid off. A quarter of the population was on poor relief. They called it the cotton famine, but this really was a man-made famine. Britain was in the doldrums, and the South's cotton bonds were riding high. Yet the South's ability to manipulate the bond market depended on one overriding condition: that investors could be sure of taking physical possession of the cotton which underpinned the bonds if the South failed to make its interest payments. And that's why the fall of New Orleans on April the 28th, 1862, was the real turning point in the American Civil War. Now that the South's main port was in Union hands, any investor who wanted to lay his hands on Southern cotton had to run the Union's formidable naval blockade.